It's easy for us to point the finger and say that X, B, or C, or D cause pain to me or cause pain to others, but we forget that we also cause pain in the world. But when you look into John 3:16, we understand that it's about forgiveness. But the Bible says that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, for all those that believe shall not perish, but they will win, or they conquer the eternal life. He so loved the world. The Greek word for world there in John 3:16 is what? Cosmos. It means universe. God loves the universe, not just the world, the universe, the entire creation. So that makes you and me not absent of it. It means that God has to, the God loved the world and He has to send His Son, His only begotten Son, because the world was rotten, dying in the sins and trespasses, moving without direction, moving without God. And it still does. I heard the final message of our pastor and main director of Remar International and pastor, the main pastor of Body of Messiah Christian Church International, Pastor Miguel Diaz, and he was saying that we still have to see that God did not stop to break mankind. COVID-19 pandemic, it is nothing. The tendency is to the things to get worse, because there is no, the people are not broken yet. You could see like a few glimpses of people and churches and groups of people. In the beginning of the pandemic, everybody was a bit afraid, so many people, they got closer to God. But many were those that they got closer to God just for a moment, when the things start getting back to normal, or when we start getting used to the things, then we go back to the same habits. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, that we should not conform with this world. We should not conform with this world, but in other words, to renew our mind. What many people during the pandemic, the first lockdown, for example, what they did is that they got closer to God, and as soon as they got used to, let's put it the word, they conformed with the world, they moved away from God. I thought that this is it. I thought that now this is the end of times. But as soon as they see, no, they have a vaccine, the things are getting better, the was lockdown 5, now it's 4, then it's 3, things are getting better. And then we start putting God aside. How many in the ministry is like that too? When we feel strong, when we feel weak and we feel in need, we go to the Lord. We can break in tears in the sermon. We can break in tears when the pastor does a calling to the front, or when the pastor is preaching and it does touch our emotions instead of our spirit and our mind. It touches our emotions. But then as soon as we start getting better, things are getting better, we start moving away from God. God does not move away from us. Pray attention. We move away from God. And many are like that. As soon as we have what we want, we run. Micah chapter 7, verse 14 and 2:17. Micah, a book of the Old Testament, the prophets. Micah chapter 7, verse 14 until 17. Feed your people with your staff, the flock of your inheritance that dwells alone on the mountain in the midst of Carmel. Peace in Bashan and Gilead, and in past I will show them wonders like the day you came out of Egypt. The nations will see and be ashamed of all their mightiness. They will put their hands on their mouths, they will deaf their ears, they will lick the dust like a snake, like the serpents of the earth. They will tremble in their confines. They will be terrified on the Lord of the Lord our God, and they will fear you. Micah 7:14 to 17. Today is what we are doing to feed the people. with the staff. Or myself as a pastor, for example, is what I'm doing to feed you with the staff. And you, with your house, fed your family with your staff and with the staff. We are entitled to feed one another with the staff. This is a prophetic word for this world. Shame comes to the world for its wickedness. They will put their hand over their mouth in surprise at what God is going to manifest. The powerful will be locked up in jails. We are already seeing it. Judge, but we'll see it more and more. Before the judgment of God, they will fear before Him, and they will respect the servants of God, because God is going to raise anointed men who will be respected and consulted, like Sadrach, Daniels, Josephs, etc., etc. God is want to lift up people, not one Sadrach, but Sadrachs. He wants to lift up Daniels, Josephs, Pauls, and many other servants. He want men that had the character of the prophets that they have before, the character of the apostles that they had before. You want men like that. Men that they don't play church. Men that don't. When we speak men, we are generalizing. I'm not just saying men. I'm generalizing men and women, serious people, committed with God, committed with the Bible, committed with the life of prayer. God wants people like that. Committed that there is things that we don't do. We refuse to do it for the sake of God, for the sake of the gospel. Because we love God first. The world is going to be set with God or against God, and a great harvest is coming to this world. God wants people that is committed. This pandemic that just come to show something that is about to come. In the meantime, that you and me, or you and I, we sit and we think that everything is going to be okay, or you read the news and you see now all these advertisements saying that everything is going to be okay. It won't be okay. We need the forgiveness of the Lord. But in order for us to ask for forgiveness, we need to have humility, humbleness, to recognize that we need forgiveness. The only way you understand that you need forgiveness is you find yourself guilty. You need to find yourself guilty, not others, not your neighbor that you complain, that because he should receive forgiveness, he should repent, he should pray more, he should read more the Bible, he should. What about I should? Because salvation doesn't have nothing to do with me. Salvation is an individual thing. You will respond for you and only for you in heaven. Before God, you will respond alone, not with me by your side. You can't excuse yourself with me or any other person. You can't even excuse yourself saying that, you know what, I did not embrace God fully because of person X, B, or C, or D, or whatever. You can't. You will respond for your actions, for your deeds, according with your lifestyle here. You and I. I'm not excluding myself. We will respond. Micah, the same book, 7, 18 to 20. Micah chapter 7, 18 to 20. What God like you, who forgives wickedness and forgets the sin of the remnant of his inheritance. He did not hold back his anger forever because he delights in mercy. Will have mercy on us again. He will bury our iniquities and cast all our sins in the depths of the sea. You will fulfill the truth to Jacob and to Abraham mercy, which you swore to our fathers from ancient times. God forgives and forgets. Forgiveness is inexhaustible, and He delights in mercy. This is how we should act. In the end, He will forgive and raise up Israel. What God like you, who forgives weakness and forgets the sin of the remnant of inheritance. He did not hold back His anger forever because He delights in mercy. God delights in mercy. God delights in mercy. Mercy is that second opportunity that you have. That second that is no longer the second many times, is the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth opportunity. How many opportunities the Lord is giving to you, or I've given to you? How many? And maybe you count them by your fingers, because, oh no, this of Rimar was the first opportunity. No, how many opportunities did he give you? Even outside, when you were on drugs, when I were on drugs, when we were on crime, involved in things that we shouldn't be involved. How many opportunities he gave you? You should count all of them. You should contemplate all of them. Not just, oh no, I came to Rimar 3 times, those are the 3 opportunities that God gave me. No, there is more opportunities. In my opinion, every morning, it's an opportunity. Amen. He does not hold back his anger forever because he delights in mercy. And the Bible says in the book of Psalms that mercy, it rises in the dawn for the righteous and for the wicked. For both of them, it rises in the dawn. Both of them, they are able to attend mercy or receive mercy in the morning, in the dawn. In the end of the day, every morning that you wake up, you open your eyes, you move your fingers, you can walk, you can talk, you are okay, you feel all right, everything is in its place, you are not abnormal of anything or different from yesterday, you can say, okay, the mercies of the Lord extend upon me. I always preach or say or mention when I speak about mercy that this is my perspective about mercy. I could tell you that at least every week there is one morning that I wake up and say, and I think the mercy of the Lord extend on me again. I can feel your mercies on me. Mercies, opportunities. He is giving you another chance. Opportunities are chances. He's giving me another chance. It also means that he will bring the lost sheep, the one that was lost or is lost. You can be in the house of the Lord, yet you are a lost sheep. Do you know that? No, I'm in the church. I belong to the NGO Rimar. I work, I do all these things and this and that and so forth. Oh, I know all the ins and outs. Oh, I'm fine. No, you can be in the house of the Lord and be lost.
Amen.
You can be in the house of the Lord on your way to hell. Do you know that? Do you know that? You can be here and you can say, you can tell me, oh, you know what, I already received the Lord Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior in the front, and I was baptized, and I was this and I was that. Yet, you can be on the way to hell. Climbing, going down the stairs to hell. Not climbing, going down the stairs to hell. It also means that he will bring the lost sheep and forgive all their sins. And always the promise of peace and blessing for Israel will be placed in praise on earth. The lost sheep, the person that was lost and now it's found. We need to be broken. But we need to be broken several times. That's why churchgoer or church coming or churchgoer, it does not bring you salvation. Oh, I'm going to church. Oh, I attend the church service. Oh, I live in a community of brothers and sisters, Christian brothers and sisters and this and that. Oh no, I no longer smoke. I no longer drink. I no longer do what I used to do. I'm not involved with this and that. So it means that I inherit the heaven. Oh, you can do all those things. You won't inherit the heaven. You won't inherit the heaven because only Jesus can make you inherit heaven. Heaven is a godly thing. And for you and I to inherit heaven, we need to first of all to have a personal encounter with Jesus Christ. Not with the church, not with the pastor, not with this NGO, not with a moment of worship and praise. You need to have a personal encounter with Jesus Christ. The one that makes you fall from the horse, like Saul before he became Paul. The one that blinds your sight to see how blind you were, not to make you blind, but to make you see. Look, it even looks like I'm speaking nonsense. To make he blinds you, to make you see how blind you were. It is important. Psalms 32, verse 1 to 6. Psalms 32, verse 1 to 6 says, "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, and his sin covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not blame iniquity." Let me start again. It's interesting. "Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, and his sin covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not blame iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I was silent, my bones grew old in my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My greenery became in the dryness of summer. I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I did not cover up. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the evil of my sin. For this every saint will pray to you in the time when you can be found." This is a psalm that the King David wrote. A psalm that expresses how long he took to address the Lord concerning certain areas of his life. And the way he has the enough discernment to understand that lack of forgiveness and lack of approaching of God, when we take long to approach God, to ask for forgiveness for a matter, a serious ask for forgiveness, and what it does to our body. So he could understand, because he says, "While I was silent, my bones grew old in my groaning." While I was silent. Why? While I could not open my mouth to say, "Jehovah, forgive me, please, because I have sinned. I've been doing this and that, and I need your forgiveness." The bones, they grew old in my groaning all day long. "For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My greenery became in the dryness of summer. And then finally, I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I did not cover up." Iniquity. "I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the evil of my sin. For this every saint will pray to you in the time when you can be found." Pay attention. In the time when you can be found. Not because it can be the time that you cannot find God. Not because he don't want you to find him, but because your sin is so heavy in within you that you yourself are so away from God that then you cannot find him. He cannot be found.
Amen.
Because sin, it grew and it grew and it grew and it grew, and then it becomes like a wound that already have a scar, and the scar is very visible. And anybody that can see the scar will say, it might hurt, it might bring pain, but to you it's no longer pain. You can touch, you can even hit with something, there is no pain at all. But it should have pain, but there is no longer pain. It's cauterized. When it becomes like that, and then it's when sin grew so much that eventually the Lord, it cannot be found. People that they commit homicide, they kill another one. How do you call it? Murder, no?
Suicide.
No, that suicide is in yourself.
Homicide.
Homicide. Amen. Thank you, Suraj. People that commit homicide, the first time, it's like a scientific proof. They vomit and they vomit and they vomit. They can even stand up. They can vomit and they can stay hours. Second time, scientific proof that there is that moment as well. Until that become nothing. Your mind is cauterized. It's nothing then. Then it's just like with a pellet gun shooting a can. There is no longer nothing within the person to say that this is right and wrong. We break that nature that was placed. I was reading the the biblical version, the version, the message, Bible, the message, which is a very good version. And there it says that it's not saying in the book of Genesis chapter, in the chapter 1 and 2, it's not saying that God created man to his own image and likeness, but it says to his nature, according to his nature, his own nature. The nature of God printed in within you and me, even with our sin, it's what it makes you say, or what it makes you understand, which is good and bad, or good and evil. So when concerning homicide and many other sins, when no longer makes you confusion, you no longer have that thing if it's wrong or not. I watched a documentary once that was speaking about homosexuals, and you could hear lots of testimonies of several of them. How come in the beginning for them there is a war, either woman to woman, either man to man, doesn't really matter. A war in the mind, like this is wrong, but then I want, but it's wrong, but it's my nature, but it's wrong, something like that. Until that they assume that we play and call, oh, came out of the closet. That came out of the closet is in the end of the day, something very bad. Because it displayed that the person assumed. In other words, is the wound cauterized. We shall go against the sin of homosexuality. We won't go against the homosexual. We do not accept their deeds, but we can accept them. Preach to them. Tell them the truth. But the process that many they went, it shows that in the beginning was like a struggle for them. They did not. It looks like they were fighting with themselves, and that speaks volumes about the sin, and speaks volumes about what the King David is saying here. Until the moment that he says, "I acknowledge my sin to you," suddenly he woke up. And he acknowledged. But the process that, which was the heavy hand that he says, for day and night your hand was heavy on me. The hand of discipline, the hand of correction, the lack of joy, the lack of peace. Many they say, oh no, I need peace. Maybe your lack of peace is the heavy hand of the Lord upon you. Oh no, I need more joy. Maybe the joy you need, or the absence of joy you have, is the hand of God upon you. Doesn't have nothing to do where you live, where you stay, who you are, or who you live with. Doesn't have nothing to do with that. Has to do with the heavy hand of the Lord upon you. That's why praying is important. Prayer makes you say things like, forgive my sins, and beyond that, you know what? And may you extend your mercy upon me, please. I need the joy of salvation. I need your joy. Your joy is my strength. We need to approach God. My wife and I, we have been looking, and sometimes I ask questions to the people, random questions, and then makes me think, you know what? I think people, they don't actually read the Bible. Simple things that are in the Bible. People actually, they don't read the Bible. And it's the best habit that we can have. Somebody asked my wife, you know what? And Teresa, send me some devotionals to do. There is no devotions. I never ask for devotions to anybody. The João you see here, I always did the same. I need to preach devotionals. My knees are on the floor. I'm holding my bench or a chair. And I'm there. Give me a word. Or I sit in the computer and I wait for God, you must speak with me. And I can be 1 hour, 2 hours even. In Malbarton, how many Sundays I'm 1 hour, 2 hours there, and apparently he doesn't speak with me, and I have to beg him to speak with me. Endurance, it makes him, okay, you are being so picky, I will speak, and then he does speak. But I can't wait in devotionals of somebody, or I don't agree with that. I agree with the reading of the Word of God. You can't just pray. Then there is the opposite of people, that they pray too much. They pray. They can even pray in tongues, but then you don't read your Bible. Then what's going to happen with you? You're going to have a big heart, but no mindset. Because the word of God, it brings you a big mind, it opens your mind, and it enlightens your mindset, and it makes your mindset right, it reaches your mindset. But if you are those that won't just read, and you don't pray nothing, you will have a big head and a very small heart. But because you have a very small heart, because you don't pray that much, your big head is full of information and nothing less than information. Those that have a big heart and a very small head, they can be very charismatic, yet they have no word to feed the people. And they can be misled in every wind of doctrine because they are not able to understand the Bible. I learned very early, me and Rita, that I cannot sit there with somebody preaching without me being able to identify if what the man is saying is biblical or not. I'm sorry, I can't. I'm a fool if I sit in a chair hearing a sermon or a preacher or an evangelist or whatever, and I'm not able to identify if this is biblical or not. I can't, I'm sorry. I need to be able to identify. Not because I heard from another pastor, but because I was on my knee when God spoke with me concerning that matter. I read in the Bible. I know the doctrine. I know what God says about marriage. I know what God says about in the finances. I know what God says about friendship, about dating or girlfriend and boyfriend. I know what God says concerning how we should dress or not. I know what God says in the Bible about all the areas that it speaks when it speaks about the human being. But I cannot just sit there and waiting for the pastor to say whatever he wants to say. And then if he says, it is biblical. And if he's not? And if he's not? How many people in Portugal, Spain, South Africa, Croatia, and all the countries in the world, the pastors say, you know what, sell everything and bring the money to the church. God will bless you even more. And they do it because they have no biblical knowledge, nothing. They don't pick up the Bible to nothing. There is no habits of reading the Bible, studying the Bible. You need to have a balance. Yes, I read the Bible, but I also pray. Yes, I pray, but I also read the Bible. Leave Proverbs and Psalms aside. Read John. Read Romans. 1 and 2 Corinthians. Ephesians. Philippians. Genesis. Leviticus. Deuteronomy. Read. Read until you find the God of forgiveness. The God that forgives no matter what. Read the book of Exodus. See how stubborn the people of Israel they were. Rebellious. Always ready to worship another God. If God, Jehovah, wasn't able to manifest himself according with their expectations, immediately they will melt gold and make another God and let's worship because this one is doing nothing. But we also do this these days. It doesn't exist no longer the church people that they'll serve God without reservations. No, we serve God with reservations. Because of this and because of that. I'm waiting for this. It becomes like a reward. I serve God because of the reward. The reward of the Apostle Paul was just one. Was the eternal vocation that was in Christ Jesus. He was looking to the eternal vocation that was in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Nico. That was his target. That was his achievement, main achievement. Not the blessings, not what can I gain with the gospel, but what the gospel can gain through me. Not what can I gain from the kingdom, but what the kingdom can gain from me. What can I give to the kingdom? People like to speak about the tithing. Concerning you and me, God doesn't want 10%. But many in the church, this is what they do. Because there is a doctrine of the 10% that I give to the church. So you come and you give 10% of yourself. 10% of your service. 10% of your commitment, 10% of your mindset, 10% of your body, 10% of everything. I forgive you 10%. No. God wants it all. 100% of your labor, 100% of your finances, 100% of your resources, 100% of yourself. And every gospel that is contrary to this one, it is no longer gospel, because you are taking off the cross. Cross is the meaning of sacrifice. If there is no sacrificial life in within us, because the cross was a sacrifice for Jesus Christ, for God the Father himself, if you remove the cross of the way, it means that it is no longer. And the Apostle Paul says what? That the gospel without the cross is, in Portuguese, anathema. That means cursed. It is no longer gospel. You cannot take the cross of the way. Carry your cross and follow me.